Hi, and welcome to Have a Chat. I'm Audrey Lynch, your co-host, along with Judy Loge. And our first guest up today is actually going to join us for our quick chat portion of our show. And we have joining us Kelly Moore Dennis.
Hi,
thank
Kelly.
You for joining
Hi.
Us.
Thank yes. you for having me.
Welcome to the quick chat. Veronique had to be away, so you are going to fill in for her today, as well as give us information about what's coming up for the school.
That's great. Yeah, exactly. We want to talk a little bit about today, now being Monday, it is now full on September. The kids are all back into school.
Beautiful
and
day.
We usually like to start our first part of the show with a positive quote, and Judy's actually up.
Yes,
with
and
that.
This,
we usually take turns, so.
The quote is, I guess, more memorable to the occasion that occurred yesterday, the 15th anniversary of 9/11. Mm-hmm. So I chose to go with this one. 9/11, a day to remember that extraordinary heroes are often disguised as ordinary people and that spirit and soul are unbreakable. And that's by Stacy Alcorn.
Yeah.
And Stacy Alcorn's well known. She's an author and she's an entrepreneur and she's a consulting firm and law firm and she's well known. That was her quote.
Yeah, I when thinking back and looking back and seeing all the stories and seeing all the pictures again and that there's still so many stories out there that haven't been heard or told about what happened that day, I still remember where I was when it all happened and we all realized what was going on. It does not seem like 15 years.
No, I know.
No.
It feels so fresh, because you had mentioned before we came on air that the kids, or no, it was Veronique before she had to run off to work, that the children are actually being taught that this is a historical event as opposed to something that happened during their lifetime.
Right.
The new kids coming in because it was before they were born.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I was doing a production at Jameson Hill High School, a local theater production, The Owl and the Pussycat, with Stefan Savoy and I. And as I was delivering tickets to the show that people had purchased, I went to this one gentleman's house and he said, "You have to come in and watch this on TV." So then that weekend was such a somber weekend and everybody was just so extremely devastated that that brought a little bit of light to the Miramichi. I remember the MC for introducing our play saying this is going to make people feel a little less upset because it was traumatizing. The world was,
was
in a hole.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, they actually brought a piece of metal or steel to Newfoundland to thank them and commemorate all that they did because there was quite a few flights, 28, 36, something like that were diverted to Newfoundland.
And people just opened up their homes and
they
just
fed
them.
Strangers.
And yeah, it's complete strangers.
Exactly.
I mean,
it's
nice to be a little bit leery. Who's coming into my home? I mean, as welcoming as a hostess as I would be, I would think, I don't know these people at all.
No.
So they were really good to
Very
do that.
Very gracious. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they'll never be forgotten for it. And where were you that day?
I was in an office, working in an office with my coworker, and we had heard it on the news, so we turned on the TV and we're watching the footage, and it was just surreal.
Surreal.
And we knew of a couple of people that were traveling as well, we were very worried.
Yeah. I know that morning was a payday. I was pregnant with our third child. He was due the very next month. And I remember turning on the TV and looking and watching, and my husband was getting ready. We were going to be going to town. And I was looking, and he's like, "What are you watching?" And I was like, I don't know what I'm watching.
No.
I was thinking, is this a movie or is this real?
It seemed like a movie, a nightmare, actually.
Yeah, exactly.
Like a horror movie.
No, that's just it. And I was glued to the radio and the TV for days afterwards.
I think, people realized that there were four planes hijacked that day.
I know.
But there was the one that just went off into the ground and landed in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, because that was one of the airlines that didn't have a fourth. I think they were all loaded with hijackers, right?
Mm-hmm.
Most of the other planes had five, and they only had four. I think that's the reason why they couldn't overtake.
And they accredit the passengers as well for that flight to bring it down into the field as opposed to hitting their targets.
Which was U.S. Capitol.
Yeah. Yes.
That's
what
their target was.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, in 1993, they had tried to bomb the World Trade Center as well. Remember
that? Was
that?
Prior to that.
They had a van in the basement in the garage area, and they tried, and they did kill six people and injured about 1,000 people.
Yeah.
So it's scary. Let's talk about something more not scary.
Well, this is not scary, but might not necessarily be positive. You're going through with all the kids back to school, university, all of that. I feel like, okay, now everything's routine and I can get back to some sense of normalcy, but you're having a hard time with the empty nest.
Actually, I'm not.
No?
Not as bad as I thought. I dreaded it. It's actually a syndrome because it says that women who are, the primary role as a working mother or a stay-at-home mother, we still have that wonderful role as being the one that's there for the kids, a lot. So I thought I'm going to have to let go of my youngest to go to university, and I was thinking, oh, it's going to be painful. Do you know what? It's actually nice. It's not nice that he's away. I miss him. Mm-hmm. And my other boy is gone to his third year medical school. He's at Moncton City for the whole year.
Right.
But it gives my husband and I time to bond. It's like when you're married and you don't have kids. Mm-hmm. It's just you and him and dinner for
second
two.
Second honeymoon.
It is.
Don't be knocking on our door anytime soon.
No, but you know, it gives you time to clean your house and to...
Well, like, you clean it and it stays
right,
like that.
Yes, right.
There's the difference.
That's the difference.
No extra laundry and no extra cooking, and the dog gets more attention, and my husband gives me more attention, and I give him more attention, and so I'm doing
this
really well.
This might be a win-win.
It might be a win-win. It's a good thing, and I miss my kids terribly, but they'll be home, and I'm proud of myself for being able to let
go. We want to wish them all good luck this school year, whether you're university or elementary or all those different school grades and stuff like that. And you being on the show today actually coincides with all of that, because you're here to talk to us about the organization that you are actually the chair of, the Miramichi East Playground Committee.
That's
correct?
Right. That's right. We are raising funds for our new elementary school that's going to be built in Miramichi East, Chatham.
Yay! That a big applause.
Yeah, that's a big deal. The Building a Future for Our Children committee, prior to this committee, are the ones that got everything rolling brought that school to us. It took many years, but they stuck to it, and they brought it to us.
Kudos to that committee.
Now, what grade is that going to be?
It's going to be from K to 5.
Mm-hmm. Okay, K to 5.
We don't have a name for it yet, so we're just calling it the Miramichi East Elementary School. But
Even that's not bad.
Yeah. No. And we're looking at raising $250,000.
Ooh, that's...
It's a quarter of a million
chunk.
Dollars.
Quarter of a million?
And
right.
People wonder why we're raising so much.
This is for the playground.
This
correct?
Is for the playground. Mm-hmm. The government gives us $80,000. Okay. Mm-hmm. So really, it's $170,000 that we're looking at. Our goal is $250,000.
To raise on your own within how much? What's the time frame?
We've got a year.
1 year.
We've got 1 year. So it's quite the task. So we're really hoping the community can help us out as much as possible.
So you must have lots of things in the works.
We do.
To get this ball rolling.
We've got a fall fair coming up this Saturday, the 17th.
Okay.
Rain date's the 18th. And it's going to be great. It's $5 a person or $10 a family. Mm-hmm. And that gets you into the fair, and the kids can play on the jumping castles. There's games, face painting.
So where is this all happening?
It's at James M. Hill.
Okay. Any food?
There's lots of food. and it's from 12 to 3 as well.
That's lovely.
Yeah, there's going to be a barbecue, and we're going to have gojis as well. Mm-hmm. The kids really like that.
Yeah, we like it too. The gojis, yogurt.
The frozen yogurt, and we're going to have little sprinkles for them.
For a minute there, I thought we were talking about a Pokemon Go game. I'm like, I'm out. I don't know what we're talking about.
Yeah, no Pokemon
at this one. I don't want to be in that.
And there's going to be pony rides and petting zoo. And Kim Harris, photographer, she was on your show recently.
Yes, she was. Last show we did.
She's going to be doing photos for us. She's donating her time. So
it's
$5 a photo, but you get your photo right there.
Yeah. That's fantastic.
Yeah, that's what's great about
it. I'm so thrilled to drive by and see the construction underway.
Yes.
And let's just say that was a real big fight to get that school.
Yes,
I was on that committee in the early stages, you know, and when my son was attending one of those schools. And again, that committee, and Eileen Bowes spearheaded that in a huge way with her strong, you know, followers. And you have to kick and push for the government to do something like that.
No.
I'm sorry.
They fought,
and they would not give in. And that's what I say, keep on keeping on. Yeah. They got it.
Yeah. Yeah. So now we... We just got one more step.
One more step to have a playground and
stuff
like that.
Important.
Now, you were trying to put the money thing into perspective for me a little earlier before the show, and talking about other little playgrounds. Now, you had said down at Waterford Green,
tiny little playground cost about $40,000.
And we're talking a school
playground.
We're
talking about a great big school, elementary school. And not only is it just for the little ones, we also have to have benches and basketball courts and stuff for the 3-4s and 5s that aren't necessarily into swings
and
just silly slides and stuff like that, little
things
that the little ones like. So it's almost like two playgrounds in one.
Do you know, just to interject for one moment, the enrollment of the school, how many?
We're looking at 400 students.
Oh, that's a good number.
Yeah.
Because we're going to combine
the two schools, St. Andrews Elementary and Ian Bailey Primary. So that's about 400 students.
That's a good number. It's quite a good number.
And just back to what you were saying about the cost, we've got the equipment, we've got the installation, we've got the labor, we're also going to be moving a couple of items from our playgrounds just to save on cost. But honestly, it doesn't really save on cost because everything is in cement. at these playgrounds. So you really they have to really put a lot of labor into it to get it out, and that costs money per hour, and you've got several people. It's a lot of money.
When you compare that to, say, buying a piece of equipment new as opposed to taking the old one out, and you put that cost into it as well, it's almost probably pretty close to the same.
Yeah. So we're basically just going to get a nice playground, nothing fancy, no huge bells or whistles. And the thing I do need to mention as well, it's going to be accessible.
That is a wonderful
wheelchair
thing.
And disability accessible.
Very, very good.
And so that way it's not just going to serve our students, but the entire community.
Well, of course, if a mom has to get in there with, say, a walker or something, or a wheelchair to see her child, there she can watch the children at the playground.
Yeah. And that's it. That's a huge thing for us as well.
Good.
We've also, we're going to be applying for the Aviva Community Fund.
Good idea.
Okay.
We're looking at getting $100,000 from them.
Yes.
But it's a huge undertaking, and it's also somewhat of a long shot, but we're going to try for it anyway. We're hoping the community comes together for us.
Because that's through votes in which that happens, correct?
Yes.
Every day I could vote to say, let's put this towards the school, right? I could go on and say, this is my wish.
We're putting our application in by October 6th.
Okay.
And then from the 11th to the 28th of October
is when the voting
is? The community votes.
Okay.
You can vote every day for one project, so please vote for us.
Please do.
Yes.
Mayor Mishy's Playground Committee.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And you can vote, each person can vote, so please get every member of your family that has an email address to vote for that as well.
How long would that take? Just a check,
exactly. You're checking your email. Just go onto the site.
Give
us a vote. We have a Facebook group as well that people can join. Anybody can join. It doesn't mean you have to be part of the committee if you just want to keep abreast on what's going on.
That's right. All the details of things that are happening.
Exactly. The Miramichi East Playground Fundraising Group. That's on Facebook.
On Facebook.
We also have a website for those who aren't on Facebook, because some people don't do Facebook. Mm-hmm. It's miramichiEastPlayground.weebly.com.
Okay.
One more time. Miramichi
East Playground.weebly.com.
Weebly.com.
That's a new one.
Well, it's free.
Okay.
that's
why.
That one's free. Yeah, we need all the votes we can get for this fund to come through.
Exactly.
That would be such a boost.
Such a boost. And we'd be able to go on the momentum and really feel like we're getting somewhere. We've done a few fundraisers so far, and we're at $6,000.
Nice.
So we've got it was over the summer that we've done this. So it's a good little start to where we need to go.
Exactly.
But we still have a ways to go, and we're really hoping that we can get the community involved. That's the main thing.
Yes,
well, we can share this is a beginning. Have a chat.
Yes, exactly.
We can give updates.
Yeah,
sure,
if you have any information,
you just
let us know, and we can be sure to pass it along.
And
to our
with 400 children, you can imagine the family members that will be voting for this fund.
Yes.
The parents, the grandparents, the siblings.
Yes, exactly.
I think it'll go. Let's cross fingers.
Yeah.
For sure.
The only other thing that I wanted to mention as well is we're having a fundraising gala on May 27th of 2017.
Right.
They're planning for
Judy's going to be our MC.
Yay! I get to buy a new dress.
Yay.
Or what is the theme? Is it secret?
I will announce it now. It's a masquerade theme.
Oh, I can just go with my mask on now. I can just go like this. I don't have to put a mask. I'll just wear a nice dress.
Well, you don't have to wear a mask.
I love masquerades.
Yeah.
Do you?
I do.
I'm always a bit intimidated by them, but I have to look for a nice one now.
Yeah.
This little facial mask. So can you elaborate any on that?
Yes, we're having a Chinese auction.
Mm-hmm.
So if there's any local businesses out there that want to donate to this, you can contact me through Facebook or through the schools. We're going to need prizes for that, but we're going to be putting out letters in the new year. We're also going to have some entertainment. We're looking at getting Sistema. I don't know if you're familiar with Sistema.
Yes, we've had them on our show as well, representatives.
We're looking at getting a few of the children to play, since it is for the children.
That's right.
At the end of it, it's for the children.
Exactly.
So it would be very appropriate. And maybe some other entertainment as well. We're still in the planning stages.
So for people, I mean, everyone I think might know what a Chinese auction is. I certainly do, but some people don't.
Right.
So you might want to just explain.
It's similar to a silent auction. Mm-hmm. You have prizes, but instead of just writing down your bid, you would buy tickets, and it's a draw. So if you really want that
necklace
night away
or
necklace, then you will put more tickets in that box with the hopes of having more of a chance.
Is drawn.
And then the name is drawn.
Exactly.
And then that's who wins the prize.
And the ones I've been to, it's usually just say $20 roughly. So you can get these tickets and distribute them wherever you want.
Yeah. To whichever prizes you want to try and win.
Yeah. Then you'll say, hey, I want to buy more tickets. And that's how we raise money.
That's right.
But you've been putting a lot into the planning. When did you start forming your committee?
We started in, I would say, the end of April, early May.
Good for you.
We came up with the idea of having a yard sale, and we had a yard sale at the end of May at St. Andrews Elementary.
And that went well?
That went well for a yard sale. We raised over $2,000.
That's awesome.
Nice.
That's pretty good for a yard sale. It was the entire gym was full of stuff, it was huge.
Well,
it was huge.
Well. Should do something again
that. Even. And we've also... we had a lobster draw. We had 50 pounds of cooked lobster.
Ooh.
That was a hit.
Yes.
I love it, too.
We're
going to
do that again next year as well because that was a hit. We
and
raised a lot of money.
The art sale you could do again if you get $2,000 from that.
Yeah.
Come the spring.
Yeah. Why not?
Yeah. It's just all about volunteers and bringing the community together.
We know.
Together,
we know.
Right? Yeah, because you're one of many, correct?
Exactly. I'm not taking all the credit by any means.
No.
We've got about 20 people that come to meetings. 15 to 20 people.
That's a good crowd.
And that's just the people that want to be part of the committee and decision making.
Sure. Right.
We've still got a whole bunch of volunteers that help out
as
parents and grandparents that help out and just little things, you know, like just maybe they'll come to one event here, one event there, or only an hour here, an hour there. But you know what? It all comes together and we all work together as a team and it flourishes.
So how excited were you with a child being 8 years old? You have a boy.
Yes, I have a boy.
When you heard about this announcement for a new school near Machines.
Oh, so excited.
Ecstatic.
So excited.
I was too. I thought finally, again, because Newcastle, you know, the other side, the west side has a new school now established. And they're both going up right now.
That's right.
Exciting times. We have a payroll center going up. And,
yes,
you know,
lots
someone
of new
said
buildings,
to me last
lots
week.
Lots of growth.
Lots of growth.
That's what they said. Miramichi is on the map, literally now.
That's right.
Visible.
Yeah.
We've been having a lot of different things, like besides festivals and fundraiser and different events like that, we've had some big names come through lately. As well. And stopping here in Miramichi and nowhere else in New Brunswick. So that sort of, you know, makes us a little bit more
and
special.
And you don't necessarily hear about it. You hear about it afterwards.
Afterwards. You're like, they were here?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I sat at dinner with Mark Trudeau at a dinner with her, and you were at Brent Kessel's concert.
Yes.
And there's been so many people that have come through for, like, the hockey players for the fishing.
Oh, yes.
What was it called? The sea bass?
Oh,
what
that was a big event that they did in the spring. Yeah, it was the... Oh, we're awful. We're gonna get
that's
killed.
Not right, but it was a big event with the fishing.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Striper Cup. That's
Striper,
what it was.
Striper Cup. You can tell that's how much I'm involved
we're
with that.
We're not fishermen.
You know how much I love fishing.
No.
Not.
No. Well, we want to say thank you to Kelly for joining us today.
Thank you for having us.
I'm looking
all
forward
about
to that.
Yes, definitely. And for all our viewers out there who want more information on this, definitely check us out on Facebook. We have another great guest coming up. Ted Lynch is going to be joining us next to tell us a little bit about his career and what he's been through and up to in the last little while. So you're not going to want to miss it. Stay tuned with more Have a Chat. We'll be back right after this commercial break.
Thank you, Kelly. That's
wonderful information to have.
Okay.
Welcome back to Have a Chat. We've been having a great show so far. We just had Kelly Moore Dennis joining us, telling us all about the group that she belongs to and raising money for the playground at the new Miramichi East School that's going
it's
to be
exciting.
Built in Chatham.
Mm-hmm.
So
hard work going into that.
We want to say thank you to her for joining us. And up next, we have my brother-in-law, Ted Lynch, joining us.
Ted,
thanks for coming.
Welcome.
Thanks for asking me to be here.
Yes,
brother-in-law, so you know each other quite well.
I wanted to showcase family a little bit. We have a number of different people who call us and contact us to want to be on the show, and then we come up with our own ideas of who we want to have on. And your story is one that I wanted, if anybody hasn't heard it yet, because there might be a few people out there, how it all got started and
who
you
are.
Music, who you are,
all about you.
I'm nobody.
Yeah, you are somebody, baby. Okay.
Well, you know, I started playing the guitar probably 10 years old. I got a guitar for Christmas. Music was in our home. My mother's was a Williams from Douglasfield, and they all, 13 of them, they all play the guitar, play the piano or both, and sing. And at one point, they had a Williams choir.
Okay.
And, you know, growing up, we had kitchen parties in our home, and my mother was always singing.
Isn't that nice?
Yeah, it is. It's wonderful to have music in your home.
You're right.
And so I began to play, and then later on, I had a cousin, and Jackie Doucette, who used to sing, and she used to get me to play for her.
Uh-huh.
And then later on, I started singing myself. I got the, you know, the confidence to sing myself. And
pardon me, did you learn how to play the guitar on your own?
No, I took lessons from a fellow who's just passed away rather recently. His name is Wilf McMillan, Wilfred McMillan. And Wilfred taught me how to play the guitar, and I took lessons for 4 years.
Did you write up?
Yeah, and haven't really gotten any better since then.
Oh, wait, yeah, I don't believe it, because you're going to demonstrate in a moment.
Two CDs later.
Yeah, two CDs
to Nashville.
You know, I'm not a great guitar player, honestly. I really like to write songs, and I like the process of recording music. And it was really something that's way out there I thought would never happen. But it did. It did.
How exciting. Yeah. And you've been to Nashville.
I've been in Nashville, recorded a couple of times, and I've also been in Nashville touring.
How nice.
Wow.
It is. So you have CDs.
Exciting.
Tell us about your CDs.
Well, my first CD happened, I worked in radio, on Life Radio, and it was a bit of a discouraging time for me because I was playing everybody else's music except my own. Mm. And I just felt like it was a piece of me was dying inside because I wanted to sing and play as well.
Yeah.
So, anyway, I went to this men's breakfast and they had asked me to play, and I played four songs, and I played Amazing Grace so that all the men could sing together, and I sang a song by Paul Brandt, who I met, and Paul Brandt wrote a song called That's What I Love About Jesus, and I played that song, and I played two of my own, and after the breakfast, a gentleman came to me and he said, do you have a CD? And I said, no, I don't have a CD. He said, why not? I said, well, I have a mortgage, I have a car payment, I have a wife, I have three children, and all that stuff.
The CD helped pay for this stuff, you see?
So he said, well, you got every excuse in the book. And I said, well, it's just the way it is.
Yeah.
So to my astonishment, he turned around and he said to my boss, who was John Stewart at the time, CEO of Life Radio, and he's a pastor, and he said, you give him the time off, and I'll pay for it.
Adamant. Just
and that's
so
how
you're
it all started.
He had faith in you.
So it was. I didn't do this on my own, but I prayed.
I'm really, really happy for you.
I used to go to bed at night and say, you know, Lord, if it's possible, I'd like to make a CD someday before I'm 40.
Yes.
So I recorded the album in February of 2010, and that year I turned 40 in April.
What did you entitle it?
It was called Invade My Soul.
Oh, cool. Deep.
It's beautiful.
I like to write too.
It is. It's beautiful.
Good.
It is.
Thank you.
My kids used to, because I listen to the country music station all the time, and you say that you met Paul Brandt. It's funny, and you sang a couple of his songs, but he would come on the radio, and the kids would be like, that's Uncle Teddy, and I'm like,
so proud.
No, close. he has sang his songs, but they too were thrilled and fantastic about the fact that he has a CD and that there's someone famous.
And you have another one, I understand.
More like infamous. But,
infamous.
What's your second one about?
My second one, I was making the transition to leave the radio station and do more full-time touring and singing and making a career out of music. So another album to sell to people would certainly help that. And so in 2012, I set out to make another album. Now, after I made the first album, my dad passed away shortly after that, and I wrote a song about my dad's boots, and in honor of him and his memory, I made that the title track of the song. So that album's called His Boots.
Would you be so kind as to play that song, or would that be too emotional for you?
Oh, no, I can play
it. You think you can hold it together?
Oh, yes. And if
I'd like to hear that.
I actually had a video made of that song.
That song has its own music video. Yeah.
Wow, I'm impressed. So I want to hear you sing now. I heard you speak, and I want to hear you sing.
Okay, would you like me to grab one?
I would love you to. Yes. And you make guitars, too, don't you?
Well,
that's a little bit how this got.
I lost my voice. I toured Newfoundland, like I'm home with no voice.
My husband dreams about that happening to me. Praise for that to
all
happen.
All men.
Even for a month, he says.
Yeah.
No, that's not even funny. You lost your voice for that long.
I did. It's been 4.5 years, but it was about 15 months before I had sang again. And even now, I have to do a lot of vocal maintenance. It can be get tender.
Okay, so. I've heard about that happening with different artists. So.
Yeah.
You're not gonna make me cry with this song, are you?
Oh, I don't think so. I think we're all good. Eh?
It's beautiful in honor of your dad.
I mean, I can't remember, but I think I play this one over the capo.
Okay, I'd love to hear this.
So yeah, there is a there's a video on YouTube, and it's if you just search my name and Ted Lynch, his boots, it'll probably come up. And my uncle Lewis is actually playing dad. He was my last uncle left, and he played dad. And he has since passed away as well.
Since then, yeah. My husband is in that video, and my youngest child, you see them in the distance or sitting at the table. You
it's
really
so
have to see the music video. It's really nice.
Your dreams are coming true.
Yeah. They gathered round my mom's kitchen, thinking about what they'd be missing. Like the time he near got caught fishing after dark. Oh, the stories they would tell, reminiscing. My brother, he got his jackknife. The other, he got his watch. And my mom said to me, son, what will it be? Maybe the gun your dad used to shoot, but I want his boots. His boots been in the hen house, they've been standing on a log. They've been in the garden, even walked the family dog. They've gone the extra mile for us next of kin, and I sure want to be just like him. I want his boots.
Love it. I really love that song, and I want to hear more and more, but we only have you on for a short time. For really a beautiful voice, Ted.
Thank you.
Love it.
So tell us a little bit about when you lost your voice, what you went through, 15 months of not being able to sing. What did you do with your time? What was going through your mind?
Well, I lost my voice. I kind of, well, like I say, I worked in radio, and for some reason I picked up this Joe Radio persona of this is how you should speak, and I started speaking deeper in my throat, you know, and that's detrimental for anyone, especially a singer. Mm-hmm. So instead of just speaking, I was speaking down here, and I was like, it's CJFYFM. And just changed. So, and it just kind of became a habitual thing, you know.
Yeah, like Grover.
Bad habit.
So, anyway, that kind of got implemented in my singing. I come back from Newfoundland. I was just, it was very tender. It was swollen. And I went to Dr. Rue, you know, the ear, the throat specialist. And he said it was swollen, and he sent me for more tests. And everything looked fine, so it was obviously, it was, you know, the way I was using my voice. So anyway, I went to speech therapy, which I thought was crazy, because, you know, I was going and I was doing all this stuff.
Oh my God.
But you know what? And yes. I've got to do those things every day to maintenance my throat. I know.
I know.
We'll have to tell Veronique that's what she has to do before we let her sing on the show.
Well, for a while, that's why I had stopped going to therapy. I was like, this is not helping.
That's why I stopped going out of the house. So, lock yourself in the room and do it.
But it's a reality if you're going to be a singer. And I had no previous vocal training at all. So anyways, I went to see a lady friend of mine, Margaret Craig, teaches vocal lessons.
Beautiful lady.
And I had met Ian, her husband, on a few occasions. And Ian is a guitar builder.
He's a wonderful man, too.
They're from Scotland, and they went to Toronto in the 70s, and they moved to Miramichi a number of years ago. So I'm in the shop, and I'm looking at guitars, and I'm just kind of really studying what Ian's doing, and I'm like, I can do this. Mm-hmm. And he laughed, and he said, if I had a nickel for every time somebody said that.
Uh-huh.
So I said, no, really, I can do this. Mm. And he's like, you think so? And I'm like, I do. So anyway, I went home, and my phone rang, and it was Ian, and he said, you know, I've been looking for somebody to pass this trade on to. And he said, you're right, I think it's you. And if you'd like to come to the shop.
That's something.
So I have. I went and I built two guitars. And this is my first one.
This, you built this?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Wow, I'm so impressed.
So yeah, this is the Lynch.
You're a talented guy, Mr. Lynch.
Well, I had a good teacher.
Look at that Lynch on it and everything. It's beautiful. Can I ask how long something like that would take? I know your life is not just involved around building guitars.
It took about 300 hours.
Imagine that. It sounds beautiful, too.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
It's a gorgeous guitar.
Labor of love, I would imagine, to build something like that.
It's very tedious.
Love it.
But even because of my throat, it was like therapy. You know, for me. Yeah, exactly.
So he puts 90 degrees out, you're going.
Yeah, I just need a Hot Wheels car to go with.
Your voice is beautiful.
Thank you.
So how many songs did you have written on each album?
There's 10 songs on the first album, and there's 11 on the second.
A lot of creative thinking goes on with you.
Yeah, and I still write today. I still have, I'd like to make another album. It costs a lot of money. It's but $20,000 per album. I'm still trying to pay off the second album.
Mm-hmm.
Things came to a standstill with my voice, so so I've started touring again since then. And
what about the possibility of writing for other artists? Is that something that you've thought about? Where you love to write, because there's money to be made there as well, writing music.
You have to write a pretty good song.
I don't know.
It has to be picked up by a major artist. I do have a song that another artist has recorded. I got a phone call one day from BJ McKelvey. He's my good friend, and he's also the fellow who produced both my albums. Mm-hmm. And he said, I got this guy, we're going down to Tennessee to record. He's looking for the song. So I fired off this song, and he's like, he loves it, he wants to record it. So, all right, so I'm like, go ahead. So
might be your connection for future others.
You never
know.
You
have a little accent, Do you find? You have a little Nashville accent?
I don't know.
What's going on? Do you know Audrey?
I don't know.
I'm from Craigville, so.
I know, but you have more of a Nashville, so you just.
But I live in Blackville today.
He's an Irish boy.
Irish boy.
Yeah, don't hold that against me.
No.
So you have to go into your own place and do your thinking as any writer does, whether it's an author or. But you have to find your space. And do the thoughts just come to you, or do you have to research some
ideas? I have thoughts every single day that I could write a song about.
Nice.
The only thing is, I don't. Take the time or make the time, you know.
Mm.
Like I wrote a song about my wife that came to me. I was out piling wood. You know, I was like, my wife never stops. And that's the name of the song, She Never Stops.
We have not time for another one, do we?
That one's, I don't know. Do we have time for another one then? Not really.
Darn it.
That one's, we'll get you the CD. That one's one of the CDs as well. You sang that at the wedding.
I'd be happy to give you one. No, that wasn't that one. That was called She Loves Me.
Oh,
that's
right.
Beautiful. Where are your CDs available?
My CDs, I only sell them online through my webpage.
Okay.
And my brother, Larry Lynch.
Larry Lynch. We all know Larry.
Online. He looks after that for me, so he looks after my webpage and stuff.
So you can go on to your webpage and order one.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely. Are we able to follow and see what you're up to and what's going on? Like, if
I don't post Audrey as much as I should.
You need someone to do that for you too,
because like,
to keep your
music
page
isn't
moving.
The only thing I do. You know,
no,
like, I
that's
do
right.
some carpentry. I have a few rentals I look after.
Talented and other incomes to keep the ball rolling.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
That's quite the guitar. I'm super impressed that you
Thank
made
you.
That.
So you've made a second. This is your. The first one you've
this
made.
This is the first one. My second one isn't completed yet.
Okay.
I just have to spray lacquer on it and
love it,
and put the neck on the body and the bridge and stuff on
it's
it.
Almost
and string
complete.
It. So it's pretty
My
much.
Gosh.
Now is that second guitar one that you're going to play, or will it
oh,
be
Oh, definitely
for sale?
No. It's going to be mine.
Yeah, it's your baby.
Yeah,
this is your love. You know, you made
I
all
kinda
that inlay pearl, is it? Mother pearl.
That's abalone.
Abalone.
And
because it is
this
a special
is
wood, isn't it? Some parts of the guitar.
Yes, this is Honduras mahogany neck, and the back and sides
gorgeous.
Are Kurulian boya from South Africa.
And look at these; they're stunning. The gold.
This is bear claw sitka spruce, and
what
this
is
all
bear claw citrus.
See this here little wave, and
yes,
that's what they call bear claw sitka spruce.
Handsome. And so, what's Ian think of it? Was he pretty impressed with your outcome?
Yeah, I think so. Ian said to me, he said, "Ted, if you took this to a luthier convention, He said, there's no one there that would ever believe that this was the first guitar you built.
Well, I mean, like I said,
wow. I said, Ian, that says a lot about you, because you're my teacher.
He taught you, exactly. The strap's incredible.
I don't know where that came from. It's probably an off an old guitar that I had years
ago. I like it all, because I could never in a million years make something like that. I know I couldn't.
Yeah, well, it's fun. I really enjoy it. And I hope to open up my own shop at some point.
That would be, you've got great plans.
I have a lot of plans.
You have a lot of plans, and you've accomplished a lot. Yes. Good stuff. So proud of you on
Thank
the show,
you.
And your voice
Thank
is wonderful.
Much.
We love the song.
Yes,
I'm sure the
definitely.
Viewers did as well.
No, that's just it. Ted's the father of three beautiful girls, by the way,
that's
as well.
Full-time job right there.
Yeah.
And my wife's January.
Yes.
And she's from Blackville, and that's how
she's
I ended up moving
girl.
To Blackville.
Her name is
yes.
January?
January,
that's
yeah.
That's pretty.
Yeah. It's different and it's unique and it's lovely, and we want to thank you so much for joining
so
us
nice.
Today and telling
thank
us
you, ladies.
All about your career, and keep us updated with what's coming up. And
Come
and
back again.
Yeah,
definitely.
I wish
Veronique
could have been here, because I heard she like wanted to sing.
I was telling
okay.
him a little bit.
We would have just been
exactly. No. We'll have to tell her that's what she has to do. Again, thank you so much for joining us.
Great
job.
Thank you
for
sure. I loved it.
Up next, we have another great guest, believe it or not, full pack show today. We have Jesse MacDonald going to be joining us, who's the executive director from the Miramichi Rod restaurant, 1809. So
Jesse.
We're going to talk a little food next, now that we've been talking all this music. So don't go away. We'll be back with more Have a Chat. Hi, and welcome back to Have a Chat. I'm Audrey Lynch. Judy Loge is co-starring with me, as usual. Veronique's out today, but that's okay. We miss her, love her. She'll be back again next week. Joining us next, we have Jesse MacDonald from the Rod Miramichi 1809 restaurant joining us today.
Happy to have you.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah,
thanks.
We had talking about the school and our kids and then music, Kelly. And now we're going to talk about food. Like, this
good
is
variety.
This is the best show.
This is the change-up show.
Keep you on your toes.
Yes,
exactly.
With a nice jacket, which
Thank
says
you.
Jesse MacDonald, executive chef of
Thank
1809.
You.
So
Thank
tell
you.
Us a little bit about who you are.
Well, my name is Jesse MacDonald, obviously. Mm-hmm. I'm actually from Prince Edward Island originally.
So oh,
I,
you.
Yeah,
wow.
I moved over to take the head chef position at 1809 in November 2013.
Okay.
So I'm coming.
Okay.
Yeah,
been
I'm coming
here a
up.
Bit.
Yeah, I'm coming up in my three full years. So
okay.
And I came over pretty much exactly lining up whenever they announced the new renovation that we went through
That's
a
right.
year ago. Yeah.
That's right.
He went
yeah.
through all that shakeup.
Yeah,
time
yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Well, I worked part time there as a bartender.
Oh,
so I got to witness a little bit about that and the chaos.
The transformation.
Yeah. The transformation,
beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's one of those things, the biggest struggle was for our staff that are used to having their stations and their setup
that
down in the restaurant
huge.
And to to move that up to the lobby for the 6 weeks that it was up there in the long run from
it
all
was.
The way down the hall. It was
they
really adapted well, and they made it possible to keep serving our guests, which at the end of the day, that's
yeah,
what
they had
we're
moved
trying
the
to do.
Dining area where you sit down to eat to the lobby.
Yes, I know.
Yeah,
I remember.
So,
yes,
so
I certainly do know.
A little bit of a walk for our servers and whatnot, and they had to be a little bit more strategic in
Everybody
working,
probably lost 10 pounds
yeah,
running
exactly,
down
exactly,
that hall
yeah,
trying
yeah,
to
So you
to
love
serve
your work, and
yeah.
did you think you wanted to be a chef at a young age, just like during middle?
No, it's funny, I get that question a lot, actually, and it was never in my mind, it was never one of those things that I thought I wanted to do.
Right, okay.
When I had a friend when I was in grade seven, I decided I wanted to get a job. My friend, one of my close friends in school had just started that summer washing dishes.
Yes.
So I decided I'd put my name in and ended up getting a call that summer.
Good.
And I did that for one season, ended up getting a little bump up to prep cook, so I was just, peeling some carrots and peeling potatoes, but you know what I mean?
Start. Yeah.
So
there
then,
is a ladder to climb when you start in a business like that.
Yes.
Yep.
So by the time I was in, grade 11, 12, I had been cooking sort of in that professional environment for about 3 years. I competed in a skills competition for our high schools and actually placed first in province.
Kind
which,
of like the master chef.
Yeah, so it was, I like to caution people, it's a little unfair, I was competing against the sort of home ec or the foods side,
right.
of, and exactly. I had this other experience unrelated to high school, but it ended up working out for me. I got my first year paid for at the Culinary Institute of Canada.
Very nice.
Scholarship, so that was sort of the final icing on the cake that maybe this should
this
be something that
you're doing
I should pursue.
Full-time basis.
So that was when I was 17. I finally made the decision, and I'm 26 now. I've been doing it for about 15 years total in the industry. So
wow,
that's something I often think about when I think about careers I may have chosen. That's one that I definitely don't think I would be good at. I like to cook.
I don't think it crossed your mind even for a second.
No, I do. I like to cook, and I think people enjoy my cooking. Not at your level, but it takes so much time.
Yeah.
That's what you, when you have children, and it would like mine are of the nest now, obviously, but to prepare a nice meal, it doesn't happen.
No, and in a restaurant that's like a 4-star restaurant, the level and the class, because when I was young and I started working at McDonald's, and then I went to the Coffee Mill restaurant, and then the Wharf Inn, and then the
experience.
It was climbing a ladder in that service industry, the food industry, that you could see the level up. Change and there is a lot to it. It's not just for anybody.
Yeah, I think the one thing too that sort of is Miramichi specific, and I think in the last year or two even, the city's done a great job of realizing that people don't have the riches that we do when it comes to food here, whether it be from land, whether it be from sea. So we need to, you know, celebrate that and accentuate that when we're trying
that's
to sell the
show
city as a whole. Exactly, exactly.
Yeah. Show it
and, food is one of those things. It's really the universal language. You don't have to speak the same language to enjoy food together
that's
with someone.
True, Jesse.
Everybody gets hungry.
Yeah, and more than ever, I would say
the
now
foodies.
It's turning into entertainment. You know, what are you doing this evening? Oh, I'm going out for dinner.
Yes.
Which for a chef, it's an exciting time that people are looking at food for more than just fuel.
Yeah,
you know? So
exactly.
that is obviously
especially when it comes to dinner. I find you know what
for
I mean
sure.
in a restaurant like that. Sitting down to dinner, and in some cultures, unlike ours here, it wasn't so much before, but sitting down to dinner was an experience.
Exactly, yeah.
Sure.
Right?
Was.
It wasn't just eat and then you go.
No, you try different things. You try a little appetizer, a group appetizer, a different drink with your meal.
Exactly.
Pairing wines with different meats and things like
and
that.
And don't get me wrong, at home, I like to cook, but what I'm saying is, to get that meal done in a beautiful way and the presentation, they're home the whole afternoon doing it.
No.
Yeah,
that's
exactly.
So I need mentioned, just before you come on, we had mentioned maybe we can do a little live video feed from there where we get...
That'd be fun.
They teaches us how to prepare because down at the Rod we do a farm to table.
Yeah,
that's
a
great
which
idea.
Is a big deal where it's all local, right?
Yeah, that's something that we started. We rolled it out in May, but in reality, I started about the February before.
Okay.
So first it was sell the company and the idea why there was a hunger for it with our clientele, and then it was obviously locating the producers that we wanted to work
with
the area. So it took us almost a year, a little bit. Over before we rolled it out, but it's been going great. We like I said, we run a special every day. We call it a farm to table feature.
Okay.
So it has all local New Brunswick vegetables as well as potato and
eggs.
Yeah, everything everything on the plate is all from New Brunswick.
Isn't that lovely?
We
it
have
is.
Three main suppliers. JP Gagnon is our main protein supplier, so he does all our meat for us. He's located in South Branch, a little bit down toward Rexton.
All right,
Rexton Way. He has a phenomenal operation. The
so
amount.
He has the beef, he has chicken, he has all kinds of different meats.
He has pig, he has turkey.
They
actually do, they're an abattoir, which means that they can do their own butchery. So if you're in the area, you can stop right into the farm and you can buy your pork chops for that night.
Kidding.
That is so neat.
Yeah.
You have
fresh.
Him.
You don't get fresher than that.
No, exactly.
Like,
no.
Right? Well, you're pretty fresh. You can be pretty
fresh.
Fresh.
We get our vegetables come from Rebecca Fraser Chasson in Rogersville at Terre Partagée.
Oh, right.
And we recently started using this summer Matt Trevor's at the Water Street Market Garden. He's at the farmer's market every Saturday.
That's pretty nice.
So yeah, we have a really good sort of, that's our core producers and
beautiful.
Yeah.
Well, what about the recipes? Who comes up with
that's what to create? That would be myself and my sous chef Dennis has a big hand in helping me. Dennis came on board in April and he's definitely helped sort of continue for us to grow.
He
as a
has
restaurant.
A passion
for sure.
When we go in the back to say, okay, well, what is this? Because we can, as the waitresses, we read it and we tell it to the client or the guest.
Yes.
And we're like, but we haven't got a clue what exactly he means. And he's definitely, any of the girls can go in the kitchen and we can try it and taste the sauce and he'll explain why and it just makes it so much clearer and that we can relay that to the guest.
Of course.
And then they definitely want to try it.
Yeah.
So tell us about some of the special things that you enjoy preparing.
Well, Being from PEI, seafood is my thing.
I love you.
Yeah, premium seafood.
Yeah, you gotta love them.
During the Striper Cup that you guys had mentioned earlier on the show, we had a group from out of town with the province that were coming to sort of see an event. They were thinking about running a similar type event up in Ontario. Mm. And they caught two fresh bass and they wanted them prepared for dinner. In any way, they said, we don't care as long as there's bass on the plate. So for me, that's the most fun I can have
in
the kitchen. The fish is still whole. You can butcher it in a whole bunch of different ways. You can do a lot with it.
Gives
you a lot of freedom. So that's definitely, I sort of lean toward
the... You get a chance to be extremely creative.
Exactly,
fresh
bass,
and there you were, preparing for a lot of people.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
So what would you put with that? What type of veggies, for example, with the bass,
It really depends. It's fish can be pretty forgiving.
I was going to say, there's probably some rules.
Yeah, I love fish. Fish can be pretty forgiving, especially if it's a white fish. If you have a white flesh fish, essentially, it's very mild, so it'll take on any flavor profile that you can do. So obviously, the flip side of that is, because a white fish is so light, you probably wouldn't want to put something. You could, don't get me wrong, but like a pickled beet would overpower the flavor of the fish. So you're better off with something a little milder, you know, spinach, mushroom, that type of thing. Okay. Something a little more earthy.
Okay.
When you get into, you know, salmon and trout, some of the fattier fish, then that's when you can get some of the
heartier
fish.
Salmon's a big one on the menu.
That's sort of our specialty. We serve it six different ways, and then you can choose six different sauces. We're Miramichi, it's salmon country, so
sure
generally
is,
when we get the tourists down, that's what we're looking for, so we want to accentuate that for sure.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You must have quite a staff. You're the executive staff manager, though.
Yeah.
What? Executive chef.
Yeah.
Then you have a sous chef.
Yes, and then we have between 10 and 12 cooks.
Yeah.
Plus our steward team, we have about 5 or 6, I would say. So probably we're just under 20 with myself and Dennis included as a staff.
Oh my gosh,
yeah, because there's the breakfast crowd.
Yeah.
There's the guys who cook lunch and then the supper, and sometimes they do cross over. Mm. But I know that when you're going in there, sometimes when someone's asking for something that's off the menu, you have to go check to see who it is that's cooking.
Yeah, exactly.
Because are they used to cooking that? Because it's from the menu from earlier in the day, and you don't know which guys are on the schedule, so you have to check. We'll look forward to hearing you more.
1809.
Definitely, definitely. And hopefully we'll get a chance to do a live feed from there sometime.
Yeah, hopefully.
Would be great. Thank you for joining us
with
Have a Chat. We'll see you again next week.
Bye.
And that's it.